Wakeboard men's semi-finals saw some impressive riding as always, where the best of the best get whittled down to the final six. The USA's Trevor Hansen frustratingly failed to repeat his earlier quarters performance, where he'd scored an impressive 17.1, delivering just 23.3 after this nasty fall early in his run. Some great riding as usual from his fellow American Daniel Powers and Italian Massimiliano Piferetti, but drawing in one of the highest scoring semis heat groups, it wasn't enough. Two falls saw the premature end to Thailand's Paddy Wat Jaman's Australian finals hopes, while Britain's Sam Khan and Dan Knott offered up good runs, but falls saw their final scores just short of that unforgiving final cut. The buzz in the finals was definitely local pride. The Australians seemed on fire. Tony Iacone and Brad Tunison earned access to a semis place via an earlier detour through the last chance qualifiers, but they thankfully left their worries very much behind them, Tony securing top spot in his heat and Brad second in his. Brad's brother Corey was also looking on top form, scoring well with the judges throughout the weekend and making the international final lineup a surefire crowd pleaser for the sports loving Aussies. Unlikely to buck this trend, number one seed Harley Clifford showed exactly why he's known as the man to beat, scoring the highest of the semi-finals. So with four of the six final places going to Australia, it was up to just two nationalities to represent the rest of the world. Irish rider David O'Quaith, whose riding still seems to be on a sharp upward rise, took the first of those spots, and IWWF podium regular and flatmate to Harley Clifford, Japan's Shota Tezuka, completed the final six.
Harley won this event the last 2 years, and then Tony Iacone gets really good, and also Corey and Brad Tunison, brothers. Australian guys stand up really strong right now.
All the Aussies are definitely dominating the sport lately, and we're all just pushing each other, trying to get to that next level.
I think just because we get to live an endless summer, you know, we travel to America for 6 months when it gets winter here, and then we come back when it starts to get cold there for our summer. So I guess we get to ride year round, whereas Americans in other countries only ride for a certain amount of time. So I think that gives us a good advantage, and we just love wakeboarding even more because we get to do it more often.
Yeah, definitely. You know, it's all summer for us the last like 6 months. So we've been practicing a lot where the US guys and stuff who come over haven't been practicing as much as us. So definitely got that little advantage. Plus it's our home turf, and we're definitely all gunning for the win.
Everyone brings their own unique flavor. That's one of the cool things about the whole action sports arena, is that it's everyone's creative out there in their own way. Everyone brings their own signature tricks to the table, so keeps it interesting throughout the day.
Time now to settle into the men's finals as we again join Matt Crowhurst down on the water.
The crowd standing firm, ready to watch the spectacle that is the men's final here at the IWWF Wakeboard World Cup stop in Mandurah, Western Australia. And it is Brad Tunison, Aussie rider, who is going to be backed with a whole bunch of local support, I'm sure, kicking things off. Big old tantrum to blind to start, and a huge effort on the rotation there, toe side, front side, seven. Getting a little bit too much height, overcooking it and landing way past the downside of the wake. There we see the Moby Dick going for the grab as well. So big couple of maneuvers from Brad in that first pass, even though he got a fall and a solid hit of the rail to round things off. Now Brad is one of the bigger powerhouses of the wakeboarding world in terms of his stance on the water. We can see him really charge at that wake as we see him charging at the rail to start off his second pass. Backside board slide, rotating all the way through, solid handle pass to end up right foot forward the same way he started. Popping it round to left foot forward now, a little bit of a stuff in on the wake, and that's a heelside backside 360, sorry, and you can see he was thinking about the backside 540, but getting all caught up and stuck, only just about getting the board underneath him. There's a 720 that saw him fall on in the very first pass. Landing it cleanly, that is gutsy riding from Brad. He knows he needs to come up with the goods. Huge whirly 540, so the whirly bird we saw from Caroline Jupiter in the ladies' final, plus a backside 180 on the end. Brad really stepping up his game, finishing off with a toeside Tootsie Rollers. Irish rider David O'Keefe shows his appreciation for his fellow finalist. And it is that man from Ireland, David O'Keefe, on the water right now, starting off with a big tech maneuver, coming back with another tech maneuver. So it was a Tootsie Roll followed by a front mob. Pops it back round to left foot forward to attack that wake. for an off-axis 180, getting a little melon grab in there all the way through the rotation. Indy tantrum to blind. Indy grab solid as you like. Back on his toe side edge. It's a mini backwind to backside 180, or a toe side off-axis backside 180, either or. Either way, very cleanly done. Hopping all the way on, a little bit over the tail, then onto the nose for an early handle pass, popping it back out. A full rotation to land right foot forward. Beautiful riding from David O'Keefe on that first run. And his old fellow O'Brien rider, Corey Tunison, giving him some props from the dock. We'll be seeing Corey very soon, but at the moment it is David O'Keefe setting the pace for the rest to follow. Brad Tunison came up with a killer second run. David not so comfortable on the rail that time round, coming off early. Here we see the cuff position for a toe side, backside. Seven he was going for, casing the top of the second wake. Now, very few riders do that trick ever, never mind throwing it in competition. We see the cuff position, and we see him case the top of the second wake so hard, there was no chance of him riding that out. So David, unfortunately, taking a fall on what was going to be a very high-scoring maneuver. This is the things we like to see from our riders. Going for it straight off the bat again, but unfortunately, the undoing of David for the second time running. He was certainly not thinking about just the podium. David was thinking about that number one place spot, which is cool to see from any of our riders going all out. He passes the bat on to Australian rider. We've already seen his brother ride. Now it's the younger of the two, Corey Tunison, on the water. Now this lad, very much like David, has exploded onto the scene over the past couple of years. And that is exactly why. A huge heelside frontside seven, like it was nothing. Landing it super cleanly. Now coming back right foot forward. Whirly 540 as well. Big, big maneuvers to start off his run. Those first two tricks will be scoring him very highly, especially as they were done so, so cleanly. And the Pete Rose out past the transition of the wake into the flats with the grab nice and clean. Moby Dick gets the handle round and rides that away cleanly as well. Corey looking so solid at the moment. Please don't let that be the commentator's kiss of death. It wasn't, with a dum-dum roll seamlessly in to the rail. Hops on 270, hops off 270. That is some of the tightest riding you will ever see at any event, anywhere. Corey, one of the youngsters in the pack, absolutely killing it. Under the bridge, into his second pass. It is that rail, as with the rest of the riders, that will be starting off that second run. Onto the nose, then early handle pass to backside 360 off. Cuts out wide, making sure he's getting as much time to do as many tricks as possible. Clubs up into the air, gets the board underneath him, and he grab backside 180. Then the backside five, getting a little bit hooked up on the wake, unfortunately, but still muscling that maneuver around and landing that 540-degree rotation. That was monumental. Big, mute move, getting that board so launched right up over his head. It wasn't off-axis. It was a definite invert. And then the toe side nine. Time for anything more? No, there isn't. I'm surprised he's got any energy left at all. I will be very surprised if that run from Corey does not see him find a place on the podium and one of the higher up spots as well. But there are still a few riders left to go before that decision is made. And the next is another Australian, four of them in this final. It's Tony Iacone on the water right now, pulling out wide on the Mastercraft X-Star. Hucking in on his heel side edge. It is a KGB, a back roll with a backside 360. Staying on the toe side edge to attack that weight next for his second trick. Going for the big Crow 540, getting a grab in there as well. So we've seen a full mob, we've seen a 540 mob. We saw a lot of big spins and big maneuvers from Corey, and already we're seeing Tony looking as though he knows exactly what he has to do to wedge himself onto the podium and potentially even beat Corey, but there is still a good bit of riding time now between him and getting onto that podium. Backside 540, seamlessly in and to the rail. A little bit of time to prep, hops on. 50-50 to backside three, a fairly basic rail ride, but all the way to the end, and a big shucker for the guys on the bridge enjoying this final of the IWWF wakeboarding guys riding. Under the bridge, once again, cutting out on his heel side edge. It's called a backside approach when you're digging in with your heels. Hops on to a 270 position, pushes that front leg out a little bit and rides away the 360. Now in on his toe side edge for his first weight trick. Oh, that wasn't what he was after. Tony was definitely aiming for at least a toe side seven, maybe a nine, but just throwing that rotation far too soon. But that's no worries at all, because there was no problems with that front mode five. In on his heel side edge for a nose grab roll to revert. Pops it back round to left foot forward. What's it gonna be to round off his run? To toe side, backside, off axis 180, getting the grab in there as well. He is panicking to get more tricks in, and he does. gets in the skeezer, and that is incredible riding from Tony Iacone. There was some definite high-end bangers in there from the Aussie, but is that going to be enough to get ahead of fellow Aussie Corey Tunison? It's going to be tight, and the judges will be burning holes in the paper, the amount they're having to write down. We move from Australia now, who have definitely got a dominance over this finals, to Japan with a rider, Shota Tezuka, who has had a dominance over the World Cup alongside Harley Clifford for a number of years now. He is going to do the same again. Who knows? We'll have to wait and see. But starting off with the KGB, then a big old backside off axis 180, getting a late stalefish grab in there, popping it back round to left foot forward as he charges that wake in his usual hooked up style. Moby Dick getting a grab, asking for a little bit of less speed from the driver. Toe side now to follow up. Big old 900 spinning like a top and then dropping out of the sky with plenty of time to spare. Moving into his next trick just before the rail, and once again, dropping out of that sky, getting all the rotation done nice and early. Frontside lip slide 270, oh, and just about scraping away. Getting a little bit too relaxed at the end of that run after all those high-end maneuvers, but still some killer riding from Shota, as we tend to see from this Japanese lad. Coming back under the bridge, we see the Mastercraft, that beautiful black exterior and rather crazy orange upholstery on the inside. Shota looking much more comfortable on the rail to start off his second run. Now stays out wide, gets nice and squat to explode off the wake. Oh my, that went all kinds of crazy for Shota to start off his second run. Are we going to see that again? Yeah, we are. He went up into the air and then decided what he was going to do. I think it was going to be a backside rotation of some sort, but just a little bit too much movement with the shoulders too early, left that board way out in front of him and causing the fall that is going to pile the pressure on for the rest of this run. Crow 5, easily done. He's going to have to rush now, powering back into that wake on his heel side edge. Front Mob, maybe thinking about the front Mob 5, and that is all he can squeeze in the remainder of his second pass. That is unfortunate for Shota as we move on to the next rider. And as we had with Raimi in the ladies' final, you do not want this guy, of all the guys in the world riding community, to be left on the dock with a little room to spare. It is Harley Clifford, Australian rider, one of our four in this final, who has taken every single title, much like Raimi. And Shota, who has been pushing him so hard over the past couple of seasons, has left the door open. Perhaps it is only Corey Tunison standing in Harley's way of yet another podium on the World Cup, and already looking so, so smooth as we pan out for a beautiful shot of the Mandurah estuary here in the western of Australia. Big old 900, as easy as you like. Pops it back round to left foot forward now. Indy tantrum to blind. Squeezes it back round to left foot forward to approach the rail. Backside, lip slide. Straightforward backside 270 off, as comfortable as you like. So that's incredible. Solid riding from Harley, which, let's be honest, is no surprise whatsoever. The X-Star passes back under the bridge for the final time here in Mandurah for the IWWF Wakeboard World Cup. Harley Clifford finishes off his run, frontside board slide, so exactly the same maneuver that he did on the way through. Just coming back and attacking it on his toe side edge. Now for a heelside maneuver, a huge frontside 720, getting the nose grab in as well, as only Harley seems to be able to do, finding time from somewhere. Then it's the toe side grab back roll with a backside 180. Then a stalefish late backside 360 way out into the flats. Coming back on his toe side edge now, it is the Pete Rose. A little bit lazy with the grab on that, but still a super, super clean landing. But Harley can't relax yet. There's still time for one more maneuver, and a huge one it is to round off his second run and round off the men's final. It was a whirly 540 to finish off Harley's run, and an incredibly tough job the judges have ahead of them. An amazing weekend the crowds have had, leaving them wanting for the World Cup to return in 2015.
It's been a really, really good year. The weather's been fantastic. I was talking to the skiers and the wakeboarders earlier on there, and they've just been delighted. Overall, I reckon we've probably had one of the best events to date, no question about that. I estimate there probably been 100,000 people. It's just been chock-a-block all the time. I've just seen people walking across that bridge to and fro non-stop, so it's been fantastic.
Here's the confirmation of those results. Harley Clifford dominant as ever, scoring an exceptional 90 points. Corey Tunison second after a spectacular weekend on 86.33, and Tony Iacone delivering the all-Aussie top three with a solid score of 81.
There's nothing cooler than being in your own country, having your own fans there, cheering you on, and then to come out with a win, and then to have the other two Aussies on the podium, Corey and Tony. I'm so stoked for them. And that's 3 years in a row here in Mandurah for me, so I'm going to say Mandurah is my favourite place in the world at this time. So.
Well, unfortunately, that's all we've got time for this week from Australia. Join us again next time around for coverage of the Jump Finals.